How is armature winding wound? What are the technicalities involved in armature winding? What are the technical terms related to armature winding of a DC machine? Let us learn in this video. Now you can see the image of DC machine armatures on the screen right now. But to understand, we need to have a creative visualization and imagination power. Now to ease your understanding, just assume that this is a cylindrical structure like a DC machine stator and rotor. Suppose this is the stator as you have seen earlier in the image and this is the rotor. Then if this is the cylinder and we cut this cylinder out and open it up, if you open this cylinder then it would lay flat. So if there are, say for example, these are the poles, then on the stator there would be poles like this. Okay, so if you can see, then there would be poles on the periphery as visible here, north pole and south poles in this cylinder. Okay, so they would be inside the cylindrical structure like this. Okay, you can see the north and south pole inside the stator and the rotor would be rotating inside it. Okay, so this is our structure. Now there would be armature as you have seen on the image which would be inside it. So let us assume that a cylindrical armature lies inside, okay, and there is a very small air gap and this armature rotates inside it. Okay, now if I open this armature up and then what I do is that it is a cylindrical armature, but if I cut it open and then I lay it flat, then it would be like a flat structure. So we are just opening the cylindrical armature for understanding purposes. Okay, and if I open up the poles, then it would look something like this. Okay, we can have two number of poles, we can have four number of poles. Okay, it is as per the design of the machine. So we are just converting this cylindrical structure into a flat structure for understanding. So the armature you have seen will be now understood with the help of this flat image. Okay, now just imagine these are the slots and the wires would go around it, the coils and the turns would go around it. To make the understanding simpler, I have some prop. Okay, this is similar to this one, it has a slots inside it. Okay, so this is the flat armature. If we turn it around, we bend it around, then it would be in form of a cylinder. Okay, now these are our slots of the armature. Okay, and on the top you can see the armature slot number, slot number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 and so on. Now on the commutator side, okay, there are commutator segments numbered 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Okay, now the commutator side of the armature is called the front side and the other part is called the back side. Okay, so now suppose this is the conductor that we are winding it. Okay, then the conductor length which lies inside the straight length of the armature slots is called the active length of the conductor in which the EMF is induced. Suppose this is a coil and we are winding it like this. Then these two portions, one over here and one over here, these two portions are called the conductors. This is called the overhang. Okay, it is just a connection between this conductor and this conductor. No EMF is induced inside it. So this conductor part does not take place in the energy conversion. Okay, so active conductor is this part. This is called the overhang. And now this is called a turn. Okay, if you connect two conductors together, then this is called turn. Now the coil or the windings of armature can be single turn or multi-turn. I can call this a coil which has only one turn. You can have a coil which has multiple turns. For example, this is a coil with two turns and I can also make a coil with three turns. Okay, now if it is a multi-turn coil, then this side, one side is called coil side. This is one coil side, this is other coil side. These are the coil sides. If it is a single turn coil, then the conductors of the both sides are called the coil sides. This is a coil side and this is also a coil side. So it can be a multi-turn coil or it can be a single-turn coil. If it is a multi-turn coil, then all the number of turns comprising to one side are called the coil side. Now, there is another concept which is very important. It is called pole pitch. Now, if it is a cylinder and there are, say, for example, four poles, then these poles are around the cylindrical periphery. Now, when we open this up, okay, when we open this up, then these poles would be along with the armature slots like this. If it is a two pole machine, say for example, if it is a two pole machine, okay, then pole pitch is defined as the distance between two adjacent poles in terms of armature slots or armature conductors. Now, here, while understanding the concepts of armature winding, distance wherever will be quoted will always be in terms of number of armature slots or armature conductors. So pole pitch is defined as the distance in terms of armature slots. So this is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 and 8. So the distance between two poles is 8 slots and thus the pole pitch is 8. Okay. It is also defined as periphery of armature divided by the number of poles. If this is the entire periphery, this is 360 degree and we have two number of poles, then the periphery divided by the number of poles is defined as the pole pitch. Okay. Now, just for example, we can calculate pole pitch. If suppose number of slots are 32, number of conductors are always denoted as Z. Number of conductors are also 32 and number of poles are 4. Now, these are not pole pairs, only poles. If say for example, machine has 4 poles, north, south, north and south. Then there are two pole pairs. Capital P denotes pole pairs. Two pole pairs. And P is 4 number of poles. Okay. Then the pole pitch is defined as Z divided by P or Z divided by slots, which is equal to 32 divided by 4. So here pole pitch is 8. Okay. So this is all about pole pitch. Now, coil pitch or coil span. Now, it is defined as the distance between two sides of a coil in terms of armature conductors. That is, if I am starting the coil from slot number 1 and I am going till slot number 8, then these are the two sides of the coil starting from 1 to 8. Okay. So, the coil pitch or coil span in terms of armature conductor is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Okay. Now, if coil span is equal to pole pitch, then this type of winding is called a full pitch winding. And if coil span is less than pole pitch, say for example, if pole pitch is 8, but my winding, I am starting from 1, but I am ending at 6. Then this winding, the other side of the winding is not reaching the south pole. Then in such case, such a winding is called a short pitch winding. Now, how does this affect? What happens is that if we consider the armature, which is having certain slots over here, then in case of a full pitched winding, the winding will start from this end, then it will reach up to the south pole. Okay, so EMF induced will be maximum when this conductor reaches up to the north pole, and at the same time this conductor will reach at south pole. So the EMF induced in both the sides would be in the same phase. When this is rotating, when this will reach north pole gradually, the EMF will start gradually increasing. It will be maximum when this side will reach the north pole. Then as it will rotate, this conductor will start moving away from North Pole, and thus the EMF will start decreasing. Now this conductor will reach to the South Pole, then it will be in negative direction. The same will happen for this conductor, and as they are in series, we will be able to add them up, and the resultant EMF would be like this. It would be just addition of these two. But suppose if the winding is short pitch winding, then it will start from this end, but it will not finish exactly at the South Pole, and it will have some angle alpha. This is the short pitching angle. Because of this, what will happen when this conductor side would be at the North Pole, it will have the maximum EMF. But at that time, this conductor will not be below South Pole exactly. So the induced EMF will be out of the phase by alpha angle. And we cannot just have simple arithmetic sum of this two as in the case of a full pitch winding. We need to have a vector sum of this EMF. We need to have vector sum, and thus the resultant would be less than in case of full pitched winding. So this is the effect of having short pitched winding. Now this alpha will also relate in the circular diagram as alpha degrees, and this would relate here as the phase difference. Now coming back to our model, okay. Now the commutator side has commutator segments. The number of commutator segments is always equal to the number of coils in an armature winding. Now basically there are two types of armature winding in DC machines. First is called lap winding. If I wind the coil which keeps looping over like this, then it is called a lap winding. Okay, this is an example of a lap winding. It can be a concentrated winding. Okay, a concentrated winding is where the winding sides, all the turns are in the same slot, or it can be a distributed winding. So I will start from here, and then I will start the second turn from other slot, and then I will have another turn from the next slot. I will have one more turn from the next slot. So this is called a distributed lap winding. Okay, previously we saw concentrated lap winding. The other type is called the wave winding. If I start from this side and then I take this conductor down, now I don't turn it on this side, but I turn it on the right side, then this is called a wave winding, as the shape resembles the shape of a wave. So this is called a wave type winding. Now just remember, we are just understanding in form of a flat structure. It is actually around a cylinder on the armature. Okay, now there are other types of winding. Basically, there is one open winding and closed winding. Open windings are usually used in AC machines, and closed winding are used in DC machines. Closed winding means if I start the winding, then the ending point after having all the turns will, if I trace the complete winding all around, then the ending will be connected to the starting point. Such kind of a winding is called a closed winding. DC machines have closed winding. Other type is also classification as per single layer winding and double layer winding. If there is one conductor, or if there is only one coil side in one slot, then such kind of a winding is called a single layer winding. Okay, this has either only one conductor, or if it is a multi-turn coil, multi-turn winding, then it has multiple, but only one coil side is in the one slot. But if I have two coil sides, so I will have another winding whose side is also here, then this is called a double layer winding. Now this is another coil, and coil side of second coil is also in the same slot, so it is called a double layer winding. In the same way, one more classification is called a simplex winding and a multiplex winding. If our entire armature winding has one set of closed winding, then it is called a simplex winding. If it has two sets of closed winding, then it is called duplex winding. If it has three sets, then triplex winding. Such windings are called multiplex winding. Now let us learn different pitches of the winding. So you can see an image on your screen. Now this is the diagrammatic representation of the pitches. First of all, we will start with back pitch. Suppose we are having a lap winding, okay, like this. Then the lap winding would be going around like this, or it can have winding like this. Then back pitch is defined as the distance the coil advances on the back side of the armature. Now distance is in terms of armature slots, or we can also call it distance between the start of the coil and the end of the same coil on the back side. So in this case, it is starting from this slot. So 1, 2, 3, and 4. So 4 is the back pitch. Okay, you subtract 6 minus 2, so we have 4. Okay, starting from 2, and here it is reaching up to 6. So 6 minus 2, or you can count like this. It is starting from here, so 1, 2, 3, and 4th slot. So 4 is the back pitch. Okay, now back pitch is always an odd number, and it is usually nearly equal to pole pitch. Now front pitch is the distance between the end of the first coil or turn and start of the second turn. Okay, so this is the end of the first turn, and this is the start of the next coil. So 1, 2, and 3, or 6 minus 3. So 3 is the front pitch on the front side. Okay, or we can also call it front pitch as the distance a coil advances on the front side. Now this is also always an odd number. Okay, now what is winding pitch? Winding pitch or resultant pitch is the distance between the starting side of the two coils. So here 3 minus 2, okay, third slot minus second slot, so resultant pitch is 1. Now remember, this is the case for a lap winding. Okay, we can also have resultant pitch as 2 if I have winding like this, 1 and 2. The starting of the second winding from this winding is at a distance of 2 slots. Okay, now in case of a wave winding, what will happen? The back pitch, for example, starting from 1 and then going to 4, and so 1, 2 and 3. 3 is the back pitch, and for example, I can have winding like this, and the front pitch, distance between the end of the first turn or coil and start of the second coil. So it is 1, 2, 3 and 4. So back pitch is 4, or sorry, front pitch is 4 and back pitch is 3. And the resultant pitch starting of first coil and starting of second coil. So that is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 and 7. So 7, or we can also calculate 8 minus 1. So resultant pitch is 7 in case of a wave winding. So in case of a wave winding, the resultant pitch or winding pitch is equal to back pitch plus front pitch. It would add up because the winding is starting from here, the next winding. And in case of a lap winding, it would be back pitch minus front pitch will give us this distance. Okay, so for lap winding, it is YB minus YF. Now, what is commutator pitch? Now, all these windings will always be connected to each commutator segment. So if the first turn is connected with commutator segment 1 and the second turn is connected with commutator segment 2 as indicated over here, then the commutator pitch over here is 1, 2 minus 1, that is 1. Commutator pitch is always calculated in terms of number of commutator segments. We can have a lap winding where our commutator pitch is not exactly one. We can connect this at segment number 5. Then it would be 5 minus 1. So 4 is the commutator pitch. In case of a wave winding also, the commutator pitch will not be 1. So here also the commutator pitch in case of a wave winding, and you will also be able to see an image on your screen where you can see commutator pitch in wave winding is a large number. Now there is another terminology also. If we start winding, maybe a wave winding or lap winding, I am taking example of a lap winding, I start winding. Now we are winding in a clockwise manner and I am going from left to right. Then if I keep winding and I go left to right, then I place the conductor in slots such that I am winding from left to right, as well as the coil is also moving from left to right. You can see that coil is advancing on the right side as I keep winding. This is called a progressive winding. We can also have another kind of winding in which the coil advances on the left side even when winding from left to right. If I start winding from left to right, then I can place the conductors in such a way that now you can see that the coil is moving on the left side. The coil started moving on the left side. Such kind of a winding is called a retrogressive winding. Now you learned that such, for example, this is a lap winding. Okay, and we also have another kind of winding which is called a wave winding. Then what is the difference between lap winding and wave winding? Okay, now in lap winding, the number of brushes has to be equal to the number of poles. So say for example, if we have two poles, then there would be two brushes required. And if there are four poles, then there would be four brushes required. If there are six poles, then six brushes will be required. But in case of a wave winding, the brushes can be two. Even if the poles are four, you can have four brushes, but you can also have two poles. It is not necessary to have four brushes. If even if there are six poles, you can have only two brushes. Now in case of a lap winding, the number of parallel paths created for current is equal to the number of poles always. So if there are four poles, then there are four parallel paths. If there are six poles, then there are six parallel paths. But in case of a wave winding, parallel paths are only two, be any number of poles. If there are six poles, then also parallel path will be two, and that is why we require only two brushes. Now lap winding has many parallel paths, and so it is also called parallel winding, and because of this it has a large current capacity, because it has many parallel paths for the current, so it can carry a large amount of current, and thus lap winding is suitable for low voltage high current machines. Now the disadvantage here is that for the same number of poles, if I have four poles for both lap winding and wave winding, and I have the same number of armature conductors, say for example 32, for 32 conductors and four poles, the wave winding will generate higher EMF for the same kind of configuration in lap winding. Lap winding will have less EMF. Okay. Now for generating same level of EMF, the lap winding will require more conductors, and so it would be of higher cost and it would require higher space. So wave winding is suitable for small generators of 500 to 600 volt, or we can say wave winding is suitable for high voltage low current DC machines. So this is all about armature winding of DC machines. These concepts are equivalently applicable to both DC generators as well as DC motors armature windings. Thank you for watching this video.